session on plenary, the final plenary soon. So dear all delegates, please come to the plenary hall and take your seat.
Okay.
We're off.
Okay.
Should we get the speakers up here too? No.
Yeah?
We could get the speakers up here too as well.
You're still putting on the mic.
Oh. Can we get the speakers up as well? Can we
get
Could I invite the two speakers up and come up? Prakash, can we get you mic'd up and come up?
Yes, please.
And Ron as well. We're getting everybody up here.
Teresa. Hi, welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
It's okay? Yep. It sounds as if it's making some noise now.
It just saves time having.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the final plenary session with the topic The Great Debate on electronic cigarettes. Would public health benefit from the harm reduction product? The honorable speakers are Dr. Prakash Gupta from the Healis Shekhsaria Institute for Public Health India that will deliver the topic on pro e-cigarette will harm public health and should be banned. And Professor Ron Borland from the Cancer Council of Victoria, Australia, that will deliver the topic, pro e-cigarette will benefit public health and should not be banned. Please welcome our moderators for this session, Dr. Nafsiah Mboi, Advisor of National Committee on Tobacco Control. Former Minister of Health, Republic of Indonesia, 2012 until 2014. And Dr. Judith Mackay from the Vital Strategies.
Thank you. Am I on? Teresa, am I on?
Yes.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, friends, welcome to this debate on electronic cigarettes. And as you have heard, it is my honor to be the chair and moderator of this session. And we are very fortunate to have our distinguished Dr. Judith Mackay as our co-chair moderator.
Thank you.
I will start with a brief background to set our debate in context. Judith will then introduce our two speakers and explain the flow of our meeting. The objective of today is to understand the benefits and harms of e-cigarette use and provide some consideration for regulations. My friends, there is a wide range of products called electronic cigarettes now available. Some containing nicotine, some not. Two contrasting arguments which will be presented by our prominent speakers, our top speakers, divides scientists, policymakers, and activists in the health and anti-smoking communities on the harm and benefit of e-cigarettes. Thus far, unfortunately, the body of evidence on this issue is limited, and few studies have been done in low and middle income countries. And this places all of us concerned with public policy and public practice related to tobacco control, smoking, and public health in a difficult position. Indications are that e-cigarettes have the potential to benefit adult smokers if used as complete substitute for conventional cigarettes and other combustible products. On the other hand, trends in teenage and child smoking and vaping are of great concern related to the harm and nicotine addiction. Well, anyway, I should not give the speech now because we have two fantastic speakers. So, Judith, I turn the floor to you.
Thank you. Welcome, everybody, to this plenary session. Can everybody hear me?
No. Yes, good. This session will take the form of each of the two speakers making a short 2-minute introductory statement as to where they stand on e-cigarettes. I might just say that because of the limited time for this plenary, we won't really be considering the heat-not-burn products unless these come up as a question at the end. We will stick to e-cigarettes. These 2-minute statements will then be followed by 4 questions from the chair, which each of the participants will answer. The debate will cover the rationale for action. It will not be a recitation of which country has done what, which country has regulated, if at all. And then we invite written questions from the floor. These are encouraged, and we invite you to write them on a slip of paper, and volunteers will come round and collect the questions, and they will be brought up, and they will answer those questions at the end. So we have 2 speakers today who are both towering international tobacco control figures, very experienced indeed. Ron Borland, the Nigel Gray Distinguished Fellow in Cancer Prevention in the Cancer Council of Victoria, will argue for e-cigarettes. And Prakash Gupta, the founder director of the Healis Institute of Public Health in India, will argue against them. So I'll immediately ask Ron Borland first to make his opening statement for the next 2 minutes. Ron.
Thank you very much, Judith. I'd just like to start by saying that the views I'm expressing are mine, and they vary in some respects from that of my employer, so don't take this as a Cancer Council position. Based on my 30 years of trying to understand the complexities of smoking cessation and the problems associated with stopping kids smoking, I've come to the conclusion that we're never going to reach our goal of eliminating tobacco use just using the current accepted range of, if you like, empower strategies. In my opinion, low toxicant nicotine products are by far the most potentially powerful strategy currently available to hasten the decline of smoking and reduce the smoking-related harm. I don't know what proportion of smokers we'll manage to get rid of this way, but I think it could be considerable, and the percentage we manage to get to stop smoking will be a function of the way in which we tilt the regulatory playing field. We have an opportunity to talk to regulators to tilt it in a way that will maximise the benefits. However, I do recognise that there are some serious concerns, some of which I still share and some of which I used to share but no longer think to be major problems. If we're going to allay our concerns, we need to rely on the science. And the science is more than just evidence. Science is the application of theory to evidence so that we come up with theories that help us predict the future better than we otherwise could. For a population level health problem like smoking, we need to start with data on the prevalence and trends in smoking and vaping and relevant beliefs. Any theory that can't account for what's actually happening in the community is not going to be particularly useful. Where we do have trend data, both in adults and young people, and in places where vaping is increasing, particularly the United States, the United Kingdom, and I heard at this conference in Taipei at least, smoking rates are going down, in some cases at unprecedented levels, and faster than they are in countries where vaping is less prevalent. I think the evidence is contributing to tobacco control is looking, but vaping will contribute to tobacco control is increasingly good. Banning it may be a case of killing the goose that lays the golden egg. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ron. And now could I ask Prakash to put the opposing view.
Thank you very much, Judith. Although my position is written as pro-ban, let me clarify, I'm not really a pro-ban person. What my assessment is that unrestricted availability of these products in the population as a whole will cause some harm in the short term and very big harm in long term. So that is my assessment, and my position is based on that assessment. If at all it has to be made available, accessible, it should be accessible only to smokers and to nobody else. Non-smokers do not require e-cigarettes for any reason whatsoever. Another point is that e-cigarette is not really a cigarette. Although it is called e-cigarette, it is a nicotine delivery device. Therefore, in terms of regulation, it has to be completely treated as a nicotine delivery device rather than a cigarette product. And saying that something is less harmful than cigarette is a totally nonsensical statement as far as I am concerned, as far as all public health people are concerned, because cigarette is the most harmful and hazardous product ever in the market. So everything else that comes along will be less harmful, less hazardous than cigarette. So I think I finished my notes.
Thank you. That was very clear. And then, of course, you come back. Why is the tobacco industry giants are they so eager to promote and produce them? But that is not the question I wanted to ask you. I wanted to ask you, can availability of these e-cigarettes or nicotine delivery services help smokers to completely quit nicotine use and or quit smoking combustible products?
Thank you. I must admit there are reports, individuals themselves report this, yes, these products have helped them in stopping smoking. But in terms of overall assessment, no expert body, except maybe some, but in the whole world, most of the expert bodies agree that they do not help smokers in cessation. In fact, there are studies, there are meta-analyses that show that the possibility of cessation is reduced among e-cigarette, those who are using e-cigarette. So the evidence is quite, if at all there is positive evidence, it is extremely controversial, and it is not feasible at this stage to make any policy on availability of e-cigarettes to smokers. Even then, I would say that I do not oppose availability of e-cigarette to smokers, probably as a less harmful product for smokers, but not making it available to people who don't smoke at all. So I think that's what my response to it, short response.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And what do you say, Rod?
In my view, there's really no doubt that they're helping contribute to the reduction in smoking. I think the evidence is very clear, and I disagree with Prakash on this. Some of the meta-analyses that have been done have included studies which are totally inappropriate to use to assess the question of whether they affect cessation or not. And although people have been repeatedly told about those things, it's been published that they're problematic, many people still continue to use this false data. The good data shows that vaping devices are equally effective to nicotine replacement products and more effective than placebos. The early generation devices do not appear to be more effective than other forms of nicotine replacement products. That's, I think, quite clear. But many more people are using them, and the total effect of an intervention is its efficacy times its use. Mm. So because more people are using these things, it's actually having a population level effect, whereas it hasn't for the nicotine replacement products to any appreciable degree. For example, in the UK, there are now over 3 million daily vapers, and the majority of those are ex-smokers. Most of those will have quit as a result of the vaping. It is really something that can make a difference. And this is happening in a context where many people still believe that vaping is as harmful as smoking, and except more recently in the UK, most governments have been very negative about encouraging people to use it. People are talking with their feet because they're finding it actually can help at least some of those people, but it's not going to help everybody. I think I'll leave it at that. I've got a few seconds left, but I think that this area, the answer is clear. It is helping, and it can help even better if we do change the regulatory framework to encourage people to use it and accept that it's not going to give them everything that smoking might have in their lives, but they can cope without smoking if they're prepared to accept vaping.
Okay, thank you, Ron. But then, both of you said that definitely not for young people and non-smokers. Okay, how do we prevent that to happen? How do we prevent young people from start and non-smokers actually also starting to use e-cigarette products?
This is really the controversial issue, and I think this is where...
That's good, we're here for debate, okay?
All the evidence we have is where vaping has become more common, smoking has become less common. So one aspect of the issue is, will vaping lead to kids taking up smoking? All the evidence so far is the opposite. Vaping is actually associated with reduced prevalence in smoking in the country, kids smoking in the countries where it's happening. But most of the studies have only been on monthly use, and we really need to know what happens to the progression towards daily long-term use if it's going to have public health implications. But the evidence so far is good. In no country is that not the case. There is some evidence maybe emerging in the US. There's been reports in the last few days around the electronic cigarette Juul, that it's being used by lots and lots of kids, and that is a cause for concern, and we need to have strategies in place to minimize that. We've learned a lot in public health and tobacco control about reducing uptake to kids. I think we can apply most of those strategies to the vaping issue and effectively minimize the risk of kids taking up vaping. But we need to be clear that some of the kids who are taking up vaping are the kids who would have smoked otherwise. So the fact that some kids take up vaping is not the immediate evidence that we have a public health disaster. We need to be careful about that and not overreact. Thank you.
Thank you. And what is your experience, Prakash?
It is not a very controversial issue, really, I would think, because nicotine, as any chemical report will tell us, is a highly poisonous and highly toxic substance. So obviously, when a population is exposed to a nicotine delivery device, it needs to be regulated. And if it is regulated properly, the non-smokers and youth must not have any access to it. And what is being propagated is, it is not being used right now that much by youth, is somewhat ridiculous. I mean, it is like saying that let genie get out of the bottle, and that's what is happening in some countries. And after it gets out of the bottle, it becomes a huge problem, then we will do something, whatever is feasible, to put it back.
Okay.
Right now we are seeing that all advertisement, all marketing, which is mostly through internet, of e-cigarette is completely directed towards youth, using exactly the same strategies and imagery as it was done for cigarette in 1950s, 60s, and earlier. So I think this is basically letting genie out of the bottle if we don't completely restrict marketing to not only youth, but to non-smokers.
Any other wise words related to prevention? You said regulation from the start, no ban advertising, no advertising, including in social media. Is that so?
Yes, and these days a problem, major problem is social media, internet access.
That's right.
So any regulation which is there will need to tackle that. It has been tackled. There are examples that even through internet now, yesterday there was a presentation from Punjab where e-cigarettes have been banned, Punjab state of India, and they gave an example that the regulatory authority wrote to all the e-commerce websites and they have stopped. You cannot get e-cigarettes delivered in Punjab now.
Okay.
So there are regulatory ways in which even internet deliveries and those things can be restricted.
Thank you. We still have a little bit of time to talk about prevention.
Yes,
because you also said that yes, it's good to prevent smokers and non-youth, although it's difficult, right?
It is difficult to prevent kids trying things. Any parent will tell you that. And trying dangerous things is a risk. Now, Prakash has exaggerated a couple of issues here, I think. Nicotine itself is not particularly addictive except when delivered in particular forms and delivered rapidly to the brain, and it becomes very addictive. Nicotine patches are not very addictive at all. So it's the delivery mechanism that makes a difference, and the emerging evidence suggests that the vaping devices may be a little less addictive than cigarettes. So it will not be as hard to get people off vaping devices as it's been to get people off cigarettes, if that's the case.
I see.
So we may be able to stop people using in the long term. The second point I'd make is that nicotine itself, long-term use of nicotine, is not particularly harmful. In Sweden, where it's used extensively, clean forms of this product, they have been unable to detect any adverse effects affecting premature death in an otherwise healthy population.
Thank you. I know you don't you disagree.
No, just a correction.
Okay.
Because I was quoted wrongly.
Okay.
I did not comment at all on addictiveness. My point was that nicotine is toxic, poisonous in milligram terms, and that information is a public information available to everybody.
Excellent. Thank you. But let me ask the third question, which is, can availability of electronic cigarettes then help to accelerate the end of the tobacco epidemic? I'm sure you disagree, both of you, but that's fine.
Yeah.
This is a debate.
Yeah.
Prakash.
I think it will extend the tobacco epidemic for several reasons. It kind of normalizes the behavior. For everybody, it gives them alternative, and we already know that people who are dual users are quite large in number, those who use both. And we also know that through studies that those who continue to use both do not derive any benefit in terms of lesser exposure to toxicant. Again, I would not want anyone to use the term, it is less harmful. We don't have the idea about the harm. Only thing we can say from the science that there are less toxicants to which an e-cigarette smoker is exposed. Whether ultimately he is less harmed or not, we are not still that sure. So it will decelerate the stoppage of tobacco epidemic. It is the same tobacco industry which is now getting into e-cigarette, marketing e-cigarettes as vigorously as it was marketing cigarette, and it is making profits from both ends.
Right.
So if there are e-cigarettes which are getting promoted, they are making profits from that, and they are not stopping. They have no particular plan, timely plan, to stop manufacturing combustible cigarette, and we cannot believe that having e-cigarette in market will accelerate the stoppage of smoking epidemic.
Wow, that's clear. Right. I hope you disagree with that.
I disagree with some aspects of it. I think we need to be very careful in separating out the vaping devices, the vaping nicotine liquids, from using the heat not burn products, that which are completely owned by the tobacco industry. The heat not burn ones, the tobacco industry has a minor share of the vaping market. But the industry strategy seems to be to conflate the two. If we're going to maximize the public health benefit, we need to make sure these two kinds of products are kept clearly distinct. The evidence around the reduction in toxicants associated with vaping devices is that they deliver less than 1/100th, less than 1% of the toxins on average that ordinary cigarettes do. Now, there's a couple of compounds where it's only about a half reduction, but there are many, many compounds that are dangerous which can't be detected in vaping. So if you've reduced the toxin level by 99%, we know there's a dose-response relationship between toxins and harm. We don't expect that that will be a 99% reduction in harm, and the experts who've tried to make an estimate came up with unlikely to be more than 5% of the harm. How did they do this? 99% reduction in toxins at least. What's the dose-response relationship between the likely diseases? In some it's relatively linear, but for heart disease, for example, it rises very rapidly at relatively low levels. So there's likely to be a greater risk for heart disease than there is for other things. There's also some uncertainty using the data from smokeless tobacco to vaping, because you're taking the material into your lungs rather than into your stomach. So pulling all those things together, the best estimate is around 5%. Now, the modelling that's been done, and it's modelling that's been done by people who are both pro and anti these products, indicates that if the risk is less than 30% of smoking, there's unlikely to be a scenario where there is a public health net harm. It is inconceivable that vaping would get there. By contrast, heat not burn may well be at or above that threshold. So we
Thank
need to be
you.
Clear on that.
Thank you. Now, in this confusion, we as policymakers still have to make policy, right? So in what way should governments regulate e-cigarettes, heat not burn, etc.? At this moment, I understand there is, we need more evidence, but still we do need to regulate. So in what way should governments regulate?
They should regulate within a systematic framework that is designed to maximize the public health benefits and minimize the public health risks. As I said, they need to make a clear distinction between vaping devices and very low toxicant delivery products and the heat not burn products. They also need not to be too concerned about renormalizing smoking. In fact, all the evidence is, particularly among vapers, that vaping actually further denormalizes smoking. some of the regulatory options that they need are setting upper limits on emissions of toxicants per milligram of nicotine. They need better quality control over the device and the consumables. This should include childproof closures of bottles and appropriate other mechanisms to reduce battery failure, for example. There should be a capacity to tax differentially according to the harm, so you're pushing people to the less harmful products and reducing the likelihood of dual regular use, which is the problem, not dual occasional use. We should be allowing for honest communication about the risks and the possible benefits. It's very hard for a government to say these things are a lot less harmful than cigarettes, but we're not going to let you have them. So they have to dissimulate and speak in half-truths. And that is one of the real problems we're facing in the world, not just in tobacco control, but generally. Politicians speaking half-truths. We need to ensure that sales are through sources with high probability of compliance with laws, not the backstreet guys who'll be selling them if they're banned. And we need to be restricting the access to smoke cigarettes, so it should be easier to get these devices for a smoker than to get the vaping devices. We should be reducing the incentives for an illicit market. We should be cautious about banning flavours, though. On Wednesday, the US FDA announced that it is looking at banning flavours of vaping products. Do you know what happened to the price of the tobacco industry stocks in the United States on this apparently anti-tobacco control policy? They rose by $20 billion. The analysts think banning flavours in vaping is going to favour big tobacco. Hmm. We need to be thinking about this. Finally, sensible regulation can ensure that we can potentially enhance other kind of strategies that are part of our empower strategies, if you like. We can put higher taxes on cigarettes if people can move to those alternatives rather than try to stop are unable to stop altogether. We can reduce the need for smoking zones, because if people can vape instead of smoke, they won't need to have smoking zones. So there are things that we can do better if we have these products available to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron. Prakash.
I completely disagree with the approach that Ron has suggested. That you look, there is no...
Is the mic on?
Is it okay now?
Mic, please.
Perhaps while they're sorting that out, I can just remind everybody to put in questions on a piece of paper, and we'll have these shortly. And give them to the volunteers who are dressed in blue. Thank you.
Is it working?
No.
No?
Mic, please. Okay, try again. Hello? And start from 3 minutes.
Okay. Hello? Is it audible now?
No.
Don't tell me the technology's on my side.
Yeah, I suppose so. Come on. Technology should not be on Ron's side.
Any side.
Or technology should not be on any side. This is a debate.
Yes.
Okay.
Hello?
Yes.
Is it okay?
Yes.
So I started by telling that I completely disagree with the approach that has been suggested by Ron, that let harm be established, let us find out what are the harms, and then have control policy commensurate with the harm of the product. Mm. Nowhere do we ask for a harm of a product anywhere that is newly introduced. For a newly introduced product, we always need to ask for the safety of the product, not the harm of the product. And therefore, the regulations need to be based on the safety of the product and how much safe they are. where they are, of course, it will depend upon the country and the place in what situation they are. So if they are already widespread, something like cigarette smoking, then the policies would be different. At the best, all of the Empower policies, all of the FCTC policy, even if they are very common, will need to be applied. I completely disagree that vaping should be allowed in any public place. And it is not just ideological reason. The studies show that when vaping is done, the concentration of PM2.5 particles can be as high or higher than those, for example, in shisha bars and hookah bars. And as we all know, PM2.5 concentration is a major parameter of measuring the air pollution and air toxicity. So,
thank you.
Wherever it is possible, we need to completely restrict its availability to non-smokers and youth, and at the best, if they are available, apply all policies that are there to tobacco product very strictly. No advertising, no use in public places, no display on the kiosk or selling point, which is a form of advertising.
I see.
So, and high taxes on these products. I don't know what exactly is the tax structure, but just like all other tobacco products, they need to be taxed at high rates.
Thank you. Let's give a big applause for the two speakers, because we're right on time. So we can now listen to the audience. Some of you have submitted your questions. Excellent, thank you.
So let's start the questions. But before I start the questions from the floor, I actually have a question of my own. And that is that in Asia, we have almost no studies on these new products.
That's right.
Almost all the studies have been done in North America and Europe. And we have a very different pattern of smoking here, with this extremely high male rate of over 50% and a very, very low female rate. And I wonder if the two speakers would like to comment upon whether policies that might apply to the more perhaps sophisticated smoking populations of the West, whether they have any relevance to us in Asia,
yep.
And what particularly we should do about a policy regarding e-cigarettes in Asia.
Do you want to go? I'll go first.
I think that the difference in smoking rates among women and young girls is an issue that is going to result in differences in what we find in the West, because in most Western countries, the rates of smoking among women are a little bit lower than in men, but not very different. There may be an increased risk of girls becoming attracted to vaping because it's not as smelly and nasty. That would need to be looked at very carefully. I don't know, and I agree that we need studies around that. The effect on boys, I suspect, is going to be pretty much the same sort of effect that we find in the West. Our ITC studies basically found that for many things, the same things work pretty much everywhere. Mm-hmm. In terms of advertising and anti-smoking advertising and pro-smoking advertising, for anti-smoking advertising and warnings, they probably work better in places where there hasn't been a lot of other communication about the issue. So there are some small differences, and there are differences associated with the importance of normative and cultural differences. But they're relatively small compared with the similarities.
Wow, okay, thank you.
Thank you, Prakash.
Thank you. Yes, Judith, the situation in Asian countries is quite different from Western countries. We have just our Global Adult Tobacco Survey data too that has been released, looked at that. And only about 3-4% of the population is aware of the name e-cigarette. And those who have ever tried it or used this is 2 per 10,000. So it is extremely low right now. But we have to remember that, especially in Asian population, what I see is a great deal of enthusiasm among young person to experiment with, try it, and be curious about technological products. an e-cigarette is exactly marketed as a new technological product. So youth, and that surveys also show that youth are the more exposed and more trying towards these products, and then this boy, girl, male, female difference might not be as much, might not remain as much as it is for conventional smoking that is governed more by cultural values and cultural norms.
So as in fact Ron says, when we don't really know, I mean, are we right in adopting the precautionary principle as advocated by WHO and try and keep them as much off the market as we can until we have clear evidence? It's not the first time in public health that governments have had to act on policy ahead of the evidence, but I mean, is this not a very good example that we should be extremely cautious in Asia?
Yeah. I fully agree, and I also fully agree with the example. Judith, you would remember, I think we first met more than 30 years back in the World Health Organization meeting in their headquarters on smokeless tobacco. And one of the recommendations in that meeting, since smokeless tobacco was spreading into countries where it was not at all prevalent by the multinational companies, one of the recommendations was that where the use is not established, it should not be started, it should be banned from coming. And that recommendation was applied in some countries. So it is absolutely a right approach that if it is not there, let's not have it.
Ron.
Under normal circumstances, the precautionary principle is about minimizing the risk of doing harm. The vast bulk of the harm comes from active smoking. To apply the precautionary principle to say we're not going to do something that's highly likely to reduce the harms associated with smoking in a net form with using the precautionary principle, I think is a perversion of that principle myself. I think we do need to be extremely cautious. I think we need to be having people like you, Judith, identifying the possible problems, and we need to be looking at strategies to make sure that those problems are minimized. I would certainly be supporting very strong bans on any form of promotion of vaping products, except to smokers directly who might want to use them to quit. Mm. Modern youth are very influenced by what they see in the mass media and other things. The only other thing that seems to attract them are things that are illegal. Things that are illegal and not promoted are dead boring. So it may in fact be that making them legal, but not making them terribly available, not promoting them and not allowing them to be promoted, may in fact be a more effective strategy than allowing them to be illegal and then to have the allure associated with that.
We have a question.
Just a small comment on precautionary principle. Ron has said precautionary for smokers that they get benefit of e-cigarette. I would put it other way around. Smokers are maybe 5% to at most 20% of the population in most country, in all countries of the world. So the non-smokers are like 80% to 90% of the population. And in precautionary principles, we have to take care of non-smokers much more than smokers.
Thank you. We have a question from the floor about the ethics of this. Is it actually ethical when smokers find it so difficult to stop smoking, where very few people have availability to NRT, is it actually ethical to withhold these products from smokers? Prakash, I'll ask you that first.
I don't see any ethical issue at all in this, because NRT products are far more widely available. In India, they are getting manufactured even by our largest cigarette company and available along with everywhere where candy is available. So I don't see any ethical issue is not making e-cigarette available to smokers when they have other means if they want to stop or if they want to reduce their smoking.
Ron?
I agree there is an ethical issue here. People have rights to be able to manage their lives the way they want to, as long as it's not creating major harms to the society or to others. And if they want to reduce their risk of smoking and they don't want to give up, are unable to give up smoking with the current available techniques, and depriving them of something that they think can has clear ethical concerns associated with it. And these are the issues. If you're going to restrict their access, you need to confront those issues.
Thank you. Another question from the floor is that e-cigarettes do not always contain nicotine. So is there a place for some to use non-nicotine e-cigarettes in our society?
That's an interesting question. We've been looking at the use of non-nicotine solutions in our ITC project. In the early waves, when we first started asking these questions about 2010, about 40% of people reported using them without nicotine, 40% said nicotine, and the other 20% said don't know. Now it's more like 90% say they're using with nicotine. And the group who are using without nicotine appear to be people who are not particularly dependent on nicotine. So they're using them as a sort of hand-to-mouth kind of strategy, and it doesn't seem to be associated with dependence on nicotine. Now, you can go both ways on this. At one level, if you can do something that's socially acceptable and not take nicotine in, so you can mix with your smoker friends and not use nicotine, that may be a good thing. If everybody's going around using these vaping devices from time to time, then it's probably not a particularly useful thing, but the non-nicotine users are unlikely to use them long-term. So from a public health point of view directly, it's unlikely to be a problem. It may create some social complications.
That's an interesting question. I'm reminded of non-nicotine cigarettes in India. There are herbal cigarettes that are available, advertised as 0% nicotine, and they have been available at least for 50 years. And they have approached, of course, us many persons for endorsing. They don't get that. But have never heard that they have become mainstream or anybody in any clinical trial or even in large observational study, they have helped people in stopping smoking. And in terms of regulation, Singapore has already regulated it on the regulation that they don't permit any imitation product as a cigarette product. So if they are a kind of imitation product, then they get banned there.
One difference between the vaping products, particularly with the flavors, are pleasant to use, whereas herbal cigarettes, like ordinary cigarettes, are not pleasant to use. So you don't use something unpleasant unless you're getting a drug with it, whereas it's maybe a bit more like chewing gum.
Tobacco cigarettes are, I think, most, I have not used it, I'm sorry, but from whatever I hear, they are most, for the first time user, they are most unpleasant things to use.
Yeah, and exactly.
Oh, we have a point of agreement. How unpleasant cigarettes are when you first use them. Now, here's a question about the tobacco industry's involvement, the cigarette tobacco industry. Tobacco companies are also selling e-cigarettes. Firstly, how can they? How can they sell really harmful cigarettes and the so-called less harmful e-cigarettes at the same time? And also, how does Article 5.3 of the WHO FCTC apply to tobacco companies who also sell cigarettes and call themselves part of the solution? So would you like to make a comment on the role and involvement of the traditional cigarette companies in this new epidemic?
Yes,
as soon as possible, please. We're running out of time, I think.
Sure.
Okay, very short. In India, the largest cigarette company is manufacturing an e-cigarette product also. No restriction so far. And also, they are manufacturing nicotine replacement therapy products. And now, they are building a chain of hospitals, including cancer hospitals. So it's difficult to restrict a company to do whatever they are doing.
Companies do whatever they think will make the most profits.
Right.
And they do it in a strategic way, so they protect themselves against threats. I think the vaping industry is a huge threat to the tobacco industry because it's an industry they don't think they'll be able to control. By contrast, the heat-not-burn industry, they control 100%. So their strategy is to link the heat not burn issue with the vaping issue in the hope that the tobacco control community will keep them together and try and restrict both of them.
And we must remember that when the chief executive officer of Philip Morris was asked recently, you say that you want to get out of the cigarette business, move into the heat not burn industry. How long do you think you will be selling cigarettes? And he said, at least the next 40 years. So they're not exactly moving out of selling cigarettes very rapidly. Another question, and again, really brief.
Judith, advice. I think we should really...
You think we're running out of
one
time?
One more? Yes.
Okay. What is the potential for e-cigarettes to encourage governments to phase out combustible products, and within what timeline?
If they become good enough that the majority of smokers are able to switch with less strong strategies, then it becomes easy for governments to phase out access to smoke cigarettes. So it will depend on how good they are. At the moment, the reason we aren't trying to ban cigarettes is because it's politically impossible. It will only become politically possible when there are viable alternatives for the vast majority of people who are currently smoking. If these provide it, then we may.
Prakash?
I think it is completely impossible that any government can encourage e-cigarettes and ban commercial cigarettes, because what I have understood dealing with the government, they have lots and lots of different spheres, lot of ways to think about industry and industrial ways and revenues. So to expect that government to do it, I think that is not feasible at all.
Thank you.
Okay, so unfortunately, we have to ask the two distinguished speakers to present their closing statement, if you have any.
Yes, thank you, Abhinav. The goal of tobacco control is clearly to reduce and ideally eliminate the premature morbidity and mortality associated with tobacco use. Currently, between 1/2 and 2/3 of all long-term tobacco users die prematurely or have major smoking-related morbidity. We've heard at this conference it's now around 7 million people per annum who are dying prematurely. This is a public health disaster of the highest magnitude. If this was happening in plane crashes, every government in the world would be putting billions of dollars into trying to solve it. The governments of the world have sat back, and it's only been the efforts of people like the people in this world that have pushed them into the rather limited action they've taken. We need to be getting them to take the big moves that can make the big difference. We should be creating the conditions to encourage smokers to move towards vaping, because if we do and do that successfully, we will be able to effectively eliminate smoking. Now, timeline on that, I don't know. The products are becoming increasingly good. At some point, the product will emerge which can potentially do this. I don't think we have it yet. I think we should consider the wisdom of the proverb, the best is the enemy of the good. This means the unattainable but aspirational goal of a tobacco and nicotine-free world is blinding us to the huge progress we can make by reducing the death and disease, by getting rid or greatly reducing the most toxic forms of the product. I think we're potentially turning our back on one of the great public health opportunities of our era. The vaping products were originally developed to help people quit. The reason people put that effort in was because of the effort of the people in this room. Having had that, allowing the tobacco industry to take it over or disowning it, I think we're doing ourselves a huge disservice. By unduly restricting vaping, I think we're sending a message that stopping smoking is not the number one priority. I think unless we can come up with a viable alternative strategy that can get rid of smoking and smoking-related harm more rapidly than the potential of these products, then we are just talking to ourselves. Governments are looking for advice on what to do. We need to be thinking as a community, how can we make the biggest difference and be prepared to take some risks in doing so? I think there's less to fear in this than many, including my opponent, think there is.
Thank you. Let's give a big applause to Farhan. You don't have to agree or disagree at the moment, okay? Prakash.
Yeah. You know, those who support vaping, they criticize and try to discredit single studies, every single studies or analysis that is done on the harms or less effectiveness of vaping. Now, this we know is a strategy. Every single study can be criticized. I do as an epidemiologist, we can criticize every single study. And tobacco industry adopted that tactic very well in 1960s. Every single study was criticized, tried to discredit every single study. And so what we do? Why we go by assessment, not by of one single study, but by group of experts and group of large number of studies. And if we go by that, the assessments from Australian authorities, Australian Parliamentary Committee, their health issue, European Public Health Association, World Health Organization, all so many other international, global, national health organization, their combined assessment, the message is extremely clear that e-cigarette is not the future. And no personal comment on anybody here or anywhere, but just like we learned on health effects of secondhand smoking, when there was a lot of controversy and papers were getting published criticizing those studies that showed health effects, and we came to know later on again from research studies that many of those authors were connected with the industry. Now, even among supporters of vaping, it is not impossible that there are supporters who are connected with the industry, and that is the reason for their supporting vaping rather than purely public health reasons. Whereas public health people who are opposing, I think they cannot have any vested interest, any personal interest in opposing or restricting vaping. So that's my closing statement.
Thank you. And now let me invite, round of applause for Prakash. And now I would like to invite concluding and closing remarks from Judith.
Thank you. We have decided not to put this to a vote amongst the audience. So you're not going to have to say which of the two speakers with whom you agree. I have to say this is probably the most difficult job in the whole conference,
right?
Trying to sum up this particular session. And particularly as being a moderator, my own personal views should not actually come into this. I'm actually here to sum up this debate and not really to say what I personally think. But I have lived in Asia for more than 50 years, so I'm always looking for consensus. And I do think that we actually do agree on a surprising number of things. I mean, we all agree that we must now, from now on, always include these new products in all our studies we do, in prevalence or harm or attitudes. We can't study e-cigarettes on their own because that gives us not a proper picture. We must study them together. And WHO and the GATT studies now all, in fact, do this in including e-cigarettes in their monitoring. We also need to monitor their safety and their effect, particularly this youth uptake, the dual use, and the effect of cessation. We all agree that we should have better disclosure of ingredients, because these things are full of things. We have no idea what they are, and there's hundreds of different products, and I think governments either need to ask for disclosure or they need to do the actual analysis of what's in e-cigarettes themselves. I think we all agree that we need to ban possibly all promotion, but certainly all unproven health claims from these particular products.
We need to ban marketing and sales to youth. See, all of these things we're actually agreeing upon. We all also agree that they do require warning labels on the packet, commensurate with the harm that they cause. I think we all agree that they need to be banned. Vaping needs to be banned in smoke-free areas. Most people agree with that. Ron does not. I've had a discussion with him already. But I think there would be a consensus that vaping in smoke-free areas should basically not be allowed. And I think we all agree that we need to review this evidence year by year as the science unfolds. And certainly, I think we will look to the next 5 years to really have a much clearer idea what these products are all around and whether they are a force for good or a force for even greater harm. So I think with that, we will close this debate. And the last thing I would ask is that our two speakers shake hands with each other.
Yes.
Excellent, excellent.
Thank you, Prakash.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ron.
Thank you. Thanks, Ron. Thanks.
And thank you all for being so patient.
Thank you.
May we give one round big of applause to our honorable moderators and speakers. Thank you for the fruitful discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, we proceed to the next panel discussion on the topic, the promise of WHO Framework Convention on Tobacco Control, FCTC, and impact of tobacco industry misdeeds to development.
this the power? Oh.